honey. The show's about to start.
Come in, dear.
Let's get ready to shake, rattle, and roll with the Graceland Glamour Girl, the one who puts the CC in rider, Miss Cece Glamour.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the third episode of Glamorous Pink Riders. I'm your host, Cece Glamour, and today our guest is one that you have actually heard if you've been keeping up with the series in our intro, so I'll let him take it away.
All right. Well, hello, everybody. How are y'all doing? My name is Jack Apollo. Well, it's my artist name, that is, and I go under Jack Apollo Cosplays on my Insta. And about me, I'm a rising Elvis tribute artist and a fellow diehard of all things Elvis, especially relating to the 68 comeback special and a couple of crossovers that I've been doing with a lot of the modern anime. It's a pleasure to be on the show talking to Miss Cece Glamour, and I just can't wait to talk about all things Elvis and how bringing forth his spirit has helped me find myself and also put something good into the world.
Well, I'm glad to have you on the show. And as you mentioned, we have talked about one of my favorite topics out of many.
Oh, yeah. Of course. Well, thank you very much.
Elvis. Exactly. I'm once again honored to have you on the show.
And thank you.
To actually start, the first question is, being an ETA, of course, you know, recently, the Elvis Tribute Artist Contest just finished as of today at Graceland. So tell us a little bit about your inspiration and what actually kind of pushed you in the direction to be an Elvis Tribute Artist.
Oh, absolutely. So it actually started well before I got into cosplay. I was getting into Elvis Presley and all things relating to the King of Rock and Roll, starting with a couple of pomade cans that I had in my first year of college. There was this one company called American Crew that was making all these different products like forming creams, grooming creams, traditional wax style pomades. And for a little window of time, they were making them with the King of Rock and Roll's face. And would you be cool if I brought one with you?
Of course.
Absolutely. I'm going to disappear off camera just real quick. Kind of like Elvis leaving the building, but not quite, you know? So here we go. So it started off when I was collecting a couple of these cans here. They have the forming cream with Elvis's appearance in Speedway. And so that's what kind of started getting me into listening to more of his music outside of Burning Love, which I'd already known from Lilo and Stitch. So I started listening to like Hound Dog, All Shook Up, Jailhouse Rock. And then I was browsing on YouTube one day when I found a video of his 68 comeback medley with him in the black suit, the square stage, and all the people surrounding it. And it just screamed badass for me. And this is well before I discovered cosplay. So just like, I started singing to a couple of girls like a couple of months later for this holiday event. And they're the first people to tell me that I kind of sounded and, you know, kind of looked like Elvis to some degree, but it wasn't until I saw the movie with Austin Butler that I began to kind of just get into it, because I saw a bunch of Elvis in my very first Dragon Con. And then when I decided to bring him over to Holiday Missouri, since it was a holiday con, the 68 comeback special being aired originally as a holiday special, that's really got me into kind of rehearsing, also kind of preparing myself for the comic book characters, the anime characters, and the like that Elvis would have met. How would he interact with them? And so it just became a journey of both learning the songs and learning how to play them on my guitars, and even upgrading to a couple of different guitars for a better sound, and really just channeling that very energy, that swagger that he brought with him, and just what history records him in the books for, in my opinion.
That is awesome. And I have to agree with you also on the 68 comeback suit itself. I myself have a replica of the suit. I mean, it's one of the most iconic, I'd say it's probably one of the most iconic, mm-hmm. aside from like the Eagle suit.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. And I definitely think that, in my opinion, that's another thing that Elvis should be known for, because oftentimes when I've talked to people, asked them, how much do you know about Elvis Presley? They'll tell me that oftentimes what they know is just the basics. And as usually all the suits that he wore in Vegas, I mean, they were great and all, but I definitely feel that. And I was reading in Steve Bender's book about the comeback special. It was really the 68 comeback look with the black suit, the longer sideburns, the perfectly brill creamed hair that put him back on the spotlight, both as a performer and as a musician, first and foremost. And I feel that's something that people definitely know about, but not enough. And so, certainly something that I feel deserves a lot more education, and not in a bad way, just education in terms of letting people know this is what the comeback special was. As a history minor in college, also talking about the significance of it, the effects on both contemporary American culture and international pop culture as a whole.
That is awesome. And I think, like you said, I honestly agree with everything that you just said. But another thing I also want to ask you is, what exactly got you into cosplaying?
Oh, absolutely. So starting around the time that I was getting ready for college, I'd first set up my Instagram, and I was getting a lot of recommendations of just like people dressing up as their favorite characters. I found when I started dressing up, and even before that, when I was just like in high school, I was already dressing up as a lot of my favorite characters for like Spirit Week or the occasional Halloween, even though I didn't have as much of a social life as I would later have in college, though, like the frat parties and all whatnot. So those Halloween parties, especially when I did the Terminator for about 4 years in a row, were kind of like my introduction into like cosplay, like buying, like having a look and then buying like the next better jacket, the next better pants, boots, et cetera. And that kind of spirit is something that I kind of took with me when a couple of years ago, and we missed out. I missed out on Halloween because there was a sort of threat in the Northern Virginia area, kind of an empty threat that was later proven to be false. It was like a fear of somebody destroying a public some sort of like malls or whatever. So I was advised to stay at home. But the following weekend, I had the opportunity to attend my very first Comic-Con in Rhode Island, and just being able to see like this is Halloween, but a whole lot better with a much better focus. It got me into the pop culture, or rather, yeah, the Comic-Con pop culture, as I would say, and just like first getting and like buying all the costumes. And then as somebody who always loved to do voice impressions and being on the spectrum, find having that kind of passion that allowed me to get into character and exert a certain kind of confidence that I didn't always have in the very beginning. It was just something that from that very first con blossomed into a full-on like activity. And I never thought that a movie and seeing a couple of other cosplays at a con would inspire me to bring cosplay and music together and become something of a rising Elvis tribute artist.
Once again, that is just like super cool. Of course, for the viewers who, for the viewers and listeners who actually don't know, we actually met at Dragon Con cosplaying. So,
Oh yeah, great times.
oh yeah.
And then wearing for anybody wondering, in this specific jacket, this is it's a pleather version of the Attack on Titan Survey Corps outfit for any fellow anime buffs out there. And I got, for anybody curious, I got the idea to bring together Elvis's portrayal in the adult series Agent Elvis, played by Matthew McConaughey, and just the overall spirit of the Survey Corps, where they go out and then they kill tons in the day, and then they kind of do a recon, sometimes a lot bit of downtime at night. I thought it'd be pretty cool to introduce Elvis with like now that he's finally got a cartoon of his own in the modern day, why not bring him into a bunch of different other comics that are very popular with people, and just see like how he would interact with those other characters that I was previously talking about.
That's really cool that I have to admit. That is honestly like a really cool thing to just kind of go and say, hey, because when you think about it, with a lot of comic cons and anime cons and so forth, people do it all the time. They'll take a Disney princess and say it's a Sailor Moon character, or they'll take a Doctor Who character and put in other things to take a big pop culture reference that is Elvis and to mix it with
Absolutely.
Attack on Titan is, of course, genius because Lilo and
Thank you.
Stitch made it work with going Disney and Elvis, and
Oh,
we
yeah.
can go and find a, what is it, the Elvis Stitch plushies everywhere now.
Oh, absolutely. And then when you think about like the way that Elvis has just really touched pop culture, it's really cool to see how because for anybody who's also watched the Elvis movie, Austin Butler in The Spirit of the King, I believe it's in 1975. He's talking to Olivia de Jong, Priscilla Presley, after their divorce about how he's afraid that nobody's going to remember him. And then suddenly here we are. He's getting his a biopic of his own. People still have like all these action figures of him, both like by Iron Studios or McFarlane Toys, and then everything else that he's been getting, like the apparel, the merchandise, the fact that his home is actually now a museum. Elvis is definitely, it's one of those things that I'm glad to say Elvis, got wrong about himself, and not in a bad way, but just when we look back and take a look at it from an objective historical standpoint.
Definitely, which also kind of sort of segues into my next question about movies, because I heard from a little birdie somewhere that you also are getting into the acting world.
Yes, that's true. It's been honestly pretty quiet for me because in between going to cons, what I first started to do was I joined a couple of Facebook groups within my area, within the Washington, D.C., Northern Virginia, Southern Maryland region, in order to see if I can maybe find some roles as an extra. Because for anybody who's curious, I actually used to be a high school Spanish teacher, but then I resigned because it was in an environment, it was a long commute, and it was a very It was no offense to anybody, it was a very violent how should I say, work environment, where a lot of the kids were just in the week that I resigned, there was a major fight that broke out in front of my room, and it was just becoming a very hostile environment. So I had to resign just so I could take care of my mental health and also see if what I really want to do in my life. But then after a conversation with my admin, who still is a friend and confidant to this day, she told me about how her own daughter had a had managed to find some roles as extras in the Atlanta area, and so I set out to do the same in my area if at all possible. But unfortunately, what just transpired for me was it was kind of difficult because even though there were opportunities, they were often for like a lot of either the pay wasn't that great, or they were in like longer areas where it'd be very risky for me to bring out my car or otherwise just step out. So I've kind of been in a transition period, also looking at some other potential options. But I've definitely been trying to tell myself that a lot of the great actors, a lot of the great names, not necessarily actors, but just a lot of celebrities that we knew, started off in very humble, not only humble backgrounds, but some didn't think they'd make it. Like Jo Rowling was a single mother on, I believe, surviving welfare and having to support her daughter while she was writing out Harry Potter in cafes in the UK. And so it just made me realize that while I'm not necessarily going to have the same trajectory or otherwise like life experiences as these people, it's definitely comforting to know that as long as I keep putting myself out there and always aim to have that confidence, have that concern for looking the part, acting the part, and most importantly, having good relationships with the people that I meet, then I'm setting myself up for success.
I like the outlook that you have, definitely. And the fact is, of course, what people don't understand, even with being on the back end of the camera, is that it can be very hard because, like you said, whether the commutes are long or sometimes the pay is wonky. But at the end of it, once you really get your foot in, it's kind of if you just kind of soar. But as I was told recently, with by a future guest that we'll have actually, that a lot of course, a lot of colleges that have film programs are always filming. That was something, even when I was in college, we had a lot of just different films.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's always kind of a helpful resource because, of course, you're helping future filmmakers and you can really see, okay, this might be a role that I like or this may not be. But speaking of roles, what are the type of roles that you would like to actually do?
Oh, absolutely. So that's currently a question that even I'm asking myself to this day, and I'm trying to tailor towards. But I'm always after roles that require somebody with a deep voice, somebody who can, kind of project naturally from the diaphragm, not to toot my own horn or anything. But I remember when I was growing up, I was told that I had a pretty deep voice, and so being able to, have that. And then my grandpa also did a couple of drama productions, I believe, in school. So kind of having that bit of like a legacy, even though he ultimately ended up working just in business, I still want to be able to, put my put my talents into something that other people can not only watch, but also appreciate and have that energy be something that they in turn feed off of.
That is
But yeah.
this.
Oh, I'm sorry. I do not mean to cut you off.
You are completely fine, but like that is amazing. Also, as
Yeah.
I heard you mention earlier, being like, of course, being on the spectrum, do you see yourself as like an icon or a role model to others to look up to?
Okay, so I definitely do. I mean, I don't like to think of myself. I definitely feel that one of the major there are two major mistakes that a lot of neurotypicals tend to get wrong with autism. It's either they sometimes they go to the extreme of maybe coddling or infantilizing us too much to the point where sometimes we can be a bit frustrating to them, or they sometimes might like think that we're how should we say they might think that we're so capable because of our your singular focus that they don't make any allowance for us to have like say certain like social faux pas, or sometimes they don't see like we get overwhelmed. Like for example, when I was growing up and was first diagnosed, my parents first resolved to treat me like a quote unquote normal person. And while I was able to develop like a lot of social skills and I still was able to find a sense of belonging in, say, like a lot of general ed and honors classes as I went from elementary school up through high school and even had generally normal college experience, what I felt was kind of missing from that was just not being able to really be fully myself in terms of like letting my weird out or otherwise like, being able to, being able to put on this, impression kind of energy, because to a certain degree, I was able to do it once I started being more independent. But at the same time, too, it was also just one of those things where I could talk about, like, say, needing a break, especially if I was being like, corrected a bit too much, and then me just being seen as like a softie or anything. But my goal as an aspiring actor and a performer would be not only to show like how putting forth my heart, my passion into a singular focus could definitely help me become, somebody that I want to be, but also showing other people that we as autists are far from incapable. Some, yes, there are some that might need a bit more support than others, or sometimes you might come across as being a bit too sensitive. But if you give us the right environment, you give us the right support, then we can show you just how capable we really are of not being only being an asset to say your company, your production, et cetera, but also being those kinds of people that you can really rely on in the future to be like, forthright, honest, dependable, hardworking.
That is
So that's
amazing.
what I see myself. That's what I see myself. I'm trying to convey in terms of a message to other people like myself and also others who are interested in knowing more about us.
That is amazing. Like, that is just awesome. You had me at saying to just be yourself and being a weirdo. I think that's what a lot of people in general are just afraid of. And I think honestly, regardless of where you are, even on the spectrum, or even not being on it, is a lot of people don't realize that we as in common, just in general, all have that. We're all a bunch of weirdos on this earth figuring it out.
Indeed. And definitely think that's a great point that you bring forward too, because one of the things, one of the biggest bits of wisdom that I learned was that especially as I was kind of getting used to kind of just the fact that I had high autism. I don't always like to say high functioning because that sometimes, gives off the wrong message. So I just like to say, on the, on the spectrum. But something that I first learned from my dad was the question, quote unquote, what is normal? Because even if you think about it to this day, I mean, not to say that anybody is, anybody note that two people are exactly the same, but when you think about it, there are very many, quote unquote, neurotypical things that even we autists do, like sometimes they might be playing with their hair, otherwise, like, maybe tapping multiple times. And it's a repetitious movement that gives people a certain sense of security, a certain sense of comfort, or helps them put their thoughts together. And so sometimes when people see autistic people doing their own thing, it's just something that I feel that, they should think about. It's not necessarily to say that, not necessarily to say that, they're the same as autistic people, but the fact that there's a lot of common ground between neurotypicals and autists than some realize.
I couldn't agree more with what you just said, honestly, because there's, and I think that's really, even with, to circle back to even with Elvis, is like the really cool thing is because This is a man who's also who thought he was his legacy was going to be forgotten, is bringing people from all over and everywhere and every walk of life together. And I feel like, honestly, in general, if we just understand each other the way we can understand, for example, Elvis or cosplaying, that would
Oh,
really just
yeah.
make the world a really cool place. Like, if people weren't afraid to kind of be themselves, I think the world would be a nicer place.
Oh, absolutely. And it also, and what you were just saying also connects to, it connects to this Instagram post, or social media post from Richard E. Grant, the veteran British actor who once, posted, when he was getting ready for the role of, an older or different variant of Loki in, the series. He posted that, his father would have been embarrassed about him, playing dress up in spandex or something, just to paraphrase it. And now here he is doing that exact same thing, and people are remembering him not as like class clown or a buffoon or anything, but as a variant of a well-loved comic book character. And so that's definitely something that I feel that not only the neurodivergent community, but just the Comic-Con and the pop culture community really brings to this world.
Definitely. Another question that I have to kind of to lighten it a bit more. What would you say is a weird talent that you have that nobody would expect you can do?
That is a good question, because I actually got a couple that I like to incorporate as part of like my own, persona, kind of part of my own personality. But yeah, for some people who haven't seen like my socials, I straight razor shave, so I know how to like not only use the razors to get a clean shaven result, a clean shaven face, but over the last couple of years, I taught myself how to hone, how to sharpen them. I've also sold a couple on like an Etsy shop, and also on the Facebook Marketplace, and I'm also part of that community. And it's something that I feel kind of helps me as an aspiring actor, because it's like, it's not only about, looking the role, but it's also about like kind of feeling good. And a straight razor, at least for a gentleman, can give you a lot of control over like how long do your sideburns, should your sideburns be, or what parts of your face do you want to say maybe keep a small but neat beard, et cetera. And it was also something that I learned from a lot of movies like James Bond, in Skyfall, or Woody Harrelson in the second Kingdom of the Apes movie, where he's shaving his head in front of the entire, I think, battalion or whatever it's called. And so it's just like some of those things are what taught pushed me to like look at a bunch of YouTube tutorials, and now it's something I'm very passionate about in terms of taking pictures of like my setup. And especially before a con, it kind of helps me get my game face, kind of, get into the mood, and just like, being clean shaven and getting into character and really just putting on something that people are going to remember. So that would be one thing. A couple other little, talents that I bring are, I draw. Yeah, I use mainly pen and ink, some, markers like India ink or alcohol-based markers, but it's just been a lot harder to find downtime these days, because obviously being busy with work and having a bunch of other hobbies, it's just one of those things that I have to sit down, I have to be relatively calm, or have an idea and just have an urge. And while I haven't really felt that impulse lately, it's definitely been there in terms of like, it might be something, maybe what I do is incorporate drawing into cosplay instead of just like drawing, random characters, coming up with concepts and or storyboards, like this whole Agent Elvis in Attack on Titan, or Attack on Elvis, however you want to call it. And
That
so yeah.
is just awesome. I definitely also understand too with having a whole bunch of hobbies. Think people
Oh
ask
yeah.
all the time, like, what do they'll ask me, what is it that you can do? Like, I think it's better if you ask, what is it that I haven't done yet? How do I actually got that X that
Absolutely.
recently. And they were like, what is something you can do? And jokingly went, word problems.
Yeah. It's kind of funny that you mentioned that, because I work as a daily substitute teacher, and so being able to teach like kids those, basic skills, it's, definitely something that I've had a passion for as like my quote unquote day job. But at the same time too, like teaching those basic skills and having to slow down, I feel also kind of engages like a natural actor in me, because especially when you have kids who maybe are a bit slower or otherwise need a bit more time or a little bit of like, clarification in order to understand those kinds of things. it's something that as a teacher, even as a mere substitute teacher, something that I definitely take a lot of pride in. It's always that idea that even as a substitute teacher, I'm here to make sure that kids are receiving education, but at the same time too, I also try to tap in as a less regular presence. I like to tap into their own into their own creative processes and try to inspire them. Like a couple of weeks ago, I was covering for a music teacher for a couple of days, and when she had a guitar on hand, I borrowed it and got to play a couple riffs and licks from Baby, What You Want Me to Do. And when we were talking about music, we were talking about a documentary on we're watching it and discussing it, a documentary on classical music and how a lot of major how like all the movies, all the TV shows with their own little orchestra, like in Star Wars or Mission Impossible, it wouldn't be the same without like a whole-on orchestra and band to be able to bring those like and bring those like how should I say those pieces to life in order for us to be able to use them in like say when Tom Cruise is sneaking into onto a ship or the giant finale between Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader. I even used that as an opportunity to bring in my own love for Elvis, not only on the guitar, but also discussing how during his Vegas years, he had a full-on entourage, a full-on orchestra. He had James Burton on guitar, Charlie Hodges another guitar, and so it's just really cool to see like how everything kind of comes together and makes a full-on like pop culture masterpiece.
Exactly. Now we have not that much time left for,
Oh.
well, words. We have time for one more question. This is our iconic question of the show,
Go
which is,
ahead.
if you could have dinner with any historic figure, who would it be?
That would be as still a very hard question, but living or dead?
Living or dead?
Oh my gosh. And only one, correct?
Lenient and say you can pick a couple.
Okay. Well, definitely want to I would definitely want to have dinner with Elvis Presley because in order to not only talk about how, adoring him and, really just, how his spirit inspired me, kind of gave me another voice of my own, but also being able to talk about like the creative processes. Also, if he were alive for a second time, perhaps also give him some advice on how to better, manage his career so that he would have had a much longer, even though he already has like a very long-lasting legacy. I mean, I always like to think to myself, oh, what it would have happened if he had lived to at least an older age for him to be able to enjoy the fruits of his labor without the abuses of his manager and his personal physician. So you had Colonel Tom Parker and Dr. Nick just taking off all of, taking the money from him and really not doing anything to curb his own impulses with like the spending, also the prescription abuses that ultimately led to his downfall. So that's definitely one that I would want to talk about. I'd also be interested in talking with a couple of other Elvis tribute artists who've made it professionally, such as Dean Z, who sings for like many of the Elvis events going on in Graceland and other Elvis tribute shows. Ryan Pelton, who is also an actor under the name Blake Rain, and whose story actually inspired me, how he started doing like a local competition, won, and then that's what pushed him to become an Elvis tribute artist and later an actor when he got to cover for the King and as a minor role in like a historic film, something like that. And he's also now affiliated with SAG-AFTRA. So definitely people, definitely Elvis and a couple of the tribute artists that inspired me on my journey as an aspiring actor and somebody who just really wants to put my talent out there and also make the world a shinier place, for lack of a better term.
That would be awesome. Well, as we close our show, would you like to do the honors and do it our iconic shake, rattle, and roll out?
Oh, yes. I mean, it's going to be a bit different because I don't have the script in front of me, but I hope you enjoyed shaking, rattling, rolling with Miss Cece Glamour and the King of Rock and Roll himself, Mr. Elvis Presley. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And now, our song of the day for our episode. Here's a little sneak peek of our next episode.
Taylor was a comedian and a great storyteller. And when he was younger, he used to work at an acting studio. And part of the acting studio's part of the gig was trying to figure out how to corral famous people into coming in to talk. And he was able to get Lucille Ball to come in and talk. But he wrote a beautiful piece about it in Salon Magazine, which I think was later reprinted in something called Pink Gorilla. But look that up. It's a really terrific read and kind of a funny look at who she really was.
I definitely will, because I'd love Lucille Ball.